Hi, good morning, everybody. I hope everybody is doing okay today. So we are here to present Chapter 11, Managing Employee Separation. But before that, I would like to introduce our team. We are the GTB, the Global Talented Bees. And sometimes we just want to grab the beer. So first, I would like to introduce our marketing manager, Nitin Bell, our performance manager, Tachi Saluja, I myself, operations manager, our researcher, Madeline, our human resource manager, Anmol, project manager, Yamin Islam. So today, we are going to give you a brief lecture review about importance of managing employee separation, managing turnover, separation costs. We are also going to discuss a very interesting case about Honda Canada versus Kevin Keays. We are going to discuss some point about the case that are related to our lesson. And we are hoping that after this webinar, you guys can also share your thoughts about this case. So as mentioned, to give review, I would like to call on my colleague, Sachi.
Hi guys, I'm Sakshi and I'm going to walk you through the slides of turnover. What is turnover? What are the kinds of turnover? And what are the cost of turnover that one organization faces? So basically, turnover is the termination of an individual's employment from an organization. It can be replacement of an employee or laying off an employee. So now I'm going to talk about the managing turnover, which is of two kinds, voluntary turnover and involuntary turnover. Voluntary turnover is that kind of turnover where the employee himself wants to leave the organization. And involuntary turnover is that kind of turnover where the employee doesn't want to leave the organization, but under some unavoidable circumstances, he is made to do so. So voluntary turnover can be quitting, resignation, retirement, or due to some personal causes. And involuntary turnover may be downsizing via layoffs. And if the person dies, if he is having some mental or health disabilities, so it may be involuntary turnover too. Next, I'm going to talk about the cost of turnover. There are many costs of turnover which the employment has to face, like separation costs, vacancy costs, replacement costs, and training costs. It's obvious that when one employee leaves the organization, the organization has to put another employee. So it causes a lot of time and energy, and also hiring and recruitment cost. And the next is the training cost. When new employee comes and joins in the replacement of another employee, the organization has to train him for all the activities, so which causes a lot of money too. Now I'm going to call upon Anmol. She'll give a brief background about the case, the Honda versus Keays.
Thank you, Sakshi, for your input. Now I'm going to discuss about the background of our case, that is Honda versus Kevin Keays. So for the case background, it's about an employee, Kevin Keays, who worked for Honda for about 14 years, first on an assembly line and later in data entry. 3 years before the termination, he was diagnosed with chronic fatigue syndrome. He ceased work and received disability benefits when his employer's insurer discontinued his benefits. Kevin returned to work and was placed in a disability program that allows employees to make absence from work if they provide doctor's notes confirming that their absence was related to the disability. Kevin's employer became concerned about the frequency of his absence. Moreover, the notes Kevin offered to explain his absence were vague, leaving the employer to believe that this absence may not only be related to his disability. So Honda asked Kevin to meet the Honda's company's doctor, a medical specialist, in order to determine how his case of disability could be accommodated. On the advice of Kevin's counsel, Kevin refused to meet the doctor and demanded explanation of the purpose of the meeting. On March 28, 2000, the employer gave Kevin a letter stating that they want Kevin to return to work, but Kay did not return to work. And in response to this, Honda terminated Kevin on the grounds of insubordination. So this case is an example of involuntary turnover, and my team members are going to discuss about it further in detail. Based on this vague background, we came up with few questions of concern. The main question is, what is the intention of the employer when they ask Keys to meet doctor? Is this done in good faith? Another question is, employer did not make Keys aware of the purpose. Why? Now I'm going to hand over the presentation to Madeline, who is going to discuss about the case analysis.
Thank you, Amol, for the presentation. I'm going to now to continue with the presentation. I'm going to identify how insubordination, wrong dismissal, bad faith, discrimination were related with the Keys, Kevin Keys case. Insubordination is the act of refusing an order. In the case of Kevin Keys versus Honda, insubordination is the reason of the termination. Following is the point demonstrated by Keys case, disregard of the boss authority, refusal to obey the boss. After the termination, Keys demand Honda for the wrongful dismissal. Also called wrongful discharge, is a situation with which an employee contract of employment has been terminated by the employer, where the termination breaches one or more terms of the contract for employment. Therefore, bad faith can be defined as untruthful, misleading, or unduly insensitive action against to someone, in this case of Kevin Keys. The court explained that the act attacking the employee reputation and fire him without 15 previous days and case mentally and cause mental distress are enough evidence that employer acted in bad faith, in discrimination, but not fulfilling legal or contractual obligation. Now, my colleague Jamin is going to explain the second part of the analysis of the case.
Thank you, Madeline, for your talks. I'll be talking about case analysis too. So in the first point is the reasonable notice. So reasonable notice is required when terminating an employee if just cause does not exist. So in this case, we can see that there was no termination notice given by Honda to Keys where terminating the employment. The second thing is the compensatory damages. The compensatory damages are the award in civil court cases when losses are occurred as a result of the negligence or unlawful conduct of another party. So there was compensatory damages like punitive damage and the cost of premium. The punitive damage are the damage assessed in order to punish the defendant of outrageous conduct. So in this case, the highest amount of punitive damage was given by the trial court was 5 million, which is one of the highest amount in Canadian history. But in the court of appeal, it was reduced to 1 million. But in the Supreme Court, it was totally struck, and it was decided that the punitive damage will not be given in Canadian law. And apart from that, there was a premium cost. Premium cost was given on case as entitled 25% premium cost of punitive damage on a substantial basis. So I'll pass to Nitin to make conclusion.
Thank you so much, Yamin. So guys, on June 27, 2008, the Supreme Court of Canada released its decision in Keys versus Honda and overturned the decision of the Ontario Court of Appeal and narrowed the scope of wallet's damages for the bad faith manner of dismissal. This decision arises from a decision of the Ontario Superior Court of Justice, which awarded $5 million in punitive damages to a dismissed employee in addition to 24-month salary in lieu of notice. The Ontario Court of Appeal subsequently reduced the punitive damage award to $1 million but maintained the 24-month reasonable notice, which comprised of 15 months reasonable notice plus 9 months of additional notice for bad faith, known as Wallace damages. The SCC set aside both the punitive damage award and the additional 9 months notice awarded for the bad faith manner of dismissal. We agree with this In respect to setting aside the punitive damages and cost premium, we believe that there is ample evidence that Honda acted in bad faith. Now I'll request Diana to put to sum up this. Thank you, Diana.
Nitin. So given all those, in this case, Honda faced a lot of charges in the beginning. So only because of how they manage their employee. So instead of accommodating their disability, Honda ignores accommodation of Keys' disability that resulted to termination of Keys. And it brings that, in this case, that it brings that Honda wasn't able to pay Keys what he deserved or what his right was, like the severance pay or the other the payment that he's supposed to get. So also in this case, Honda's responsibility to act in good faith was disregarded. So presenting this case brought a lot of clarity, both from employee and employer. So our team learned a lot of things about this case because, you know, we are become aware of our employment, and also if we become HR in the future, I hope that everybody also gains a lot of insights about the case. So hopefully with this, everybody give their insight, like mentioned earlier. So to end this presentation, in behalf of our team, we would like to leave you with a quote that there is no greater disability in society than inability to see persons as one, as more. So again, in behalf of our team, thank you very much.